fact, I would challenge you to go to our YouTube channel or maybe our website. Go to YouTube and just put in their search engine, The Odyssey Church, and last week's message will be one of the messages on there. And do it from the safety of your own home, okay? It's not that the message was so eloquently spoken, but they were the very words of Jesus. But they were sometimes tough words to hear, but they were the words of Jesus himself. But this week, I'm going to be a little bit easier on you, I promise. In fact, the day of title's message is More Than Rules, because our relationship with Jesus shouldn't be about rules. Now, don't get me wrong, rules are really good. But sometimes it's easier to follow a rule book, because if we have a rule book in front of us, we know whether we're doing a good job or whether we're doing a bad job, don't we? So sometimes it's easier to have a rule book in front of you so you know what you're doing. But when it comes to God, and maybe you already know this, maybe you've already experienced it, having a rule book sometimes makes it about religion. And sometimes religion can become dangerous. Now, rule books become these man-made rules, which often becomes about religion. And I don't think God is particularly happy with religion or people that are just simply religious. I think he wants so much more from us than that. I mean, maybe this is you. Maybe you felt this way. I know I had in my life. Have you ever felt like God was disappointed in you? Maybe you did something and you just think, you know, how can God even look me in the eyes or look down upon me with what I just did? Or maybe you've read some of the Bible and you know you haven't kept the rules very well. Or maybe even worse yet, some good meaning Christian person has told you about how you're always breaking the rules and how God, and even though their intentions, I don't think anybody would purposely hurt anybody, but even though their intentions are good, maybe they're telling you about how much God would be happier with you, or how much you know you're going to be away from God, or maybe God doesn't even love you because of the rules that you break, or maybe he's mad at you. Well, that's religion. You know, maybe you were brought up in a church that always pointed you to the rules, and you grew up in a household maybe that always talked about breaking God's rule, and they never pointed you to a relationship with Jesus Christ. It never pointed you towards relationship. They kept pointing you to the rules. And maybe that's why some of you haven't been to church in a while. Maybe that's why some of you stopped going to church. Or maybe that's why some of you just started to go through the motions, because you knew you couldn't keep the rules and people kept reminding you that. See, when we talk about religion, religion can actually become a wall between you and God. It becomes a wall, and that wall can be built brick by brick by brick, by shame and by guilt and by pride and judgment and insecurity. Now, I think the opposite of religion is relationship. And that's really been the main point of this entire series. Our key point, our key verse has been Luke 9:23, as I mentioned earlier. And in Luke 9:23, the gospel writer Luke, who did much research, was a doctor. He said, and Jesus is talking. He said to them all, which means he's talking to us. He says to us all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Now, it's true that following Jesus is going to require some sacrifice. It's going to require sometimes denying yourself. Relationships aren't always easy. And you know that, and I know that. But we all know that sacrifice, denying ourselves, sort of goes against our human nature. But we also know if we truly love somebody and we truly want a relationship with them, there's times that we're going to have to deny ourselves. There's times that we're going to have to do some things that maybe we aren't comfortable with or maybe we don't like to do, because if we truly love somebody, we're willing to do those things, not because there's some kind of set of rules, but because we love them. And what we also know, Jesus says, is to follow him, that the closer your relationship is with a person, the more you do those things out of love instead of because you have to. And that's especially true if you're trying to follow that person and you're trying to follow them to learn from them so that you can be more like them. So if you put this in the context of Christianity or in the context of becoming a disciple of Jesus Christ, the opposite of religion is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And a relationship with Jesus Christ can give you a defined purpose for your life. It can give you this great hope that you can't find outside of him. It can give you this incredible peace that you won't have if you don't have him in your life. See, the more you know Jesus, the more that you can break down this wall that stands between you and God that others put up with rules. The gospel is good news. Gospel, literally translated, means good news. So you know it ain't gospel unless it's good news, right? In other words, in the words of a pastor and a counselor by the name of Jack Miller, he said, "Cheer up! You're a worse sinner than you ever thought you were. But you're more loved than you ever dared to hope." Now, isn't that amazing? That's the good news. It means the closer we get to Jesus, the more we're going to see His love. And the more we see His love, the less we're going to see religion. And the less we see religion, the more we break down the wall between us and God, right?
Amen.
Now, sometimes we see people in history who have found out the hard way about this wall between us and God. Now, one of those people is a person who not only felt the effect of religion on his life, but the effect that religion had on his life affected the entire nation. The man is a man that we know as Gandhi. Now, when we say Gandhi, most of us know we're talking about a man by the name of Mohandas Gandhi. Later, he was known as Mahatma Gandhi. And he was the leader of Indian nationalism in British-ruled India. So, if it hadn't been for Gandhi himself, this independent struggle that they had would have taken longer. It would have seen much more bloodshed. It would have had more division. There had been more war. Because the senior leaders of the Hindu religion, the political groups at the time, tried to get Gandhi to respond with violence with violence. They tried to get him to respond with sword with sword. And yet, Gandhi would not do that. Gandhi continued to go after and on a path of nonviolence and one peace. Even today, Gandhi is one of the most well-respected leaders in modern history. And it's not just because of his political victories, which he had many, but it was for his life. It was for his ideals. It was for his message to his people. In fact, in India, he's known as the father of the nation.
Amen.
Gandhi was a Hindu. But what most people don't realize is Gandhi almost became a Christian.
Yes, that's true.
Gandhi was a law student. Gandhi became a lawyer. He considered himself a humble student of the Bible. He was a man who approached the Bible with faith and reverence, and he quoted it often, and he quoted the words of Jesus often. Gandhi was somebody, or Jesus was somebody who Gandhi admired very much, and he spoke often of him, particularly in his political messages and the message to his people. He would speak oftentimes the very words of Jesus from his favorite chapters of the Bible. Most of his messages are based on Matthew chapter 5 and chapter 6, which is what we know as the Sermon on the Mount. If you ever go back in history and listen to what Jesus or what Gandhi spoke, he was speaking the words of Jesus. But although Gandhi admired Jesus, considered himself to be a student of the Bible, Gandhi still would not become a Christian. But he explored becoming a Christian. In fact, when he was in law school, he was so serious about becoming a Christian, he decided to attend a small local church that was near the university where he was studying. After he decided to go there, he went to his first story, and there was an English usher, an elder of the church, standing at the top of these marble steps. Coffer. Now, coffer is a derogatory word. Coffer is a word that was belittled. We have a word like that in our English language. It's the worst thing that you can call an African American.
Right.
Gandhi, being the humble man that he was, said, "You know, I'd just like to attend worship here." Church elder, this Christian man, snapped back at him, "There is no room in this church for coffers. Now you get out of here, or I'll have my men throw you down these marble steps." Mm-hmm. That one single instant, that one face-to-face meeting with the Christian forced Gandhi to never consider being a Christian again.
That's right.
But what he did do is he adopted what he found in the life and the works of Jesus Christ. In fact, one time in a speech to the women missionaries, on July 28, 1925, you can look it up, Gandhi said, "Although I am myself not a Christian, I wish to respectfully place before you the essence of the Sermon on the Mount. There are thousands of men and women, though today they may not have heard of the Bible, they may not have heard of Jesus, They have more faith and are more God-fearing than Christians who know the Bible and talk of its Ten Commandments. To a Christian missionary, Gandhi once says, to live the gospel is the most effective way, the most effective in the beginning, the most effective in the middle, and the most effective in the end. Not just preach, but live the life according to the light. If therefore you go on serving people and ask them also to serve, they would understand. But instead you quote John 3:16 and ask them to believe it. And that has a no appeal to me, and people will not understand it. The gospel will be more powerful when practiced and preached.
Oh, that's good.
And then Gandhi gives this wonderful example. Now you think about this. He says, a rose does not need to preach. It simply spreads its fragrance. The fragrance is its own sermon. The fragrance of religious and spiritual life is much finer and much subtler than that of the rose. So I want you to think about this. This statement Gandhi made when the missionary, there was a missionary by the name of Earl Stanley Jones, and he asked Gandhi this question. He said, Mr. Gandhi, even though you quote the words of Christ often, why is it that you so animately reject becoming his follower? And Gandhi replied, oh, I don't reject Jesus Christ. I love Christ. It's just that so many of you Christians are so unlike your Christ. And then he added this. If Christians acted like Christ, the whole world would be Christian. So what kept Gandhi from being a Christian? Christians kept Gandhi from being a Christian. Christians who were more interested in the rules than they were in a relationship. Christians who were more interested in religion than they were in Jesus. They had these certain rules in their church, and they were enforcing them, and the rules sometimes, they become cumbersome, and they become burdensome, and rules never inspire grace. And rules won't keep people around. Rules can, and they often do, become religion, and religion can be a wall between us and between God. Now, I want you to imagine, can you imagine when Gandhi walked up those steps to go to that church and was met by the elder of the church with love and grace that Jesus calls us to do instead of hating rules? Can you imagine how the world might be different today? The number of people whose lives would be changed in India, with the world's second largest population of 1.2 billion people, was predominantly Christian instead of predominantly Hindu. If Gandhi was welcomed with unconditional love and with grace instead of met with legalistic rules and hate, and he decided to become a follower of Jesus and speak as if Jesus was the Lord over his life, how the world would be different today. John McDowell made this statement: rules without a relationship leads to rebellion. Rules without a relationship leads to rebellion. See, that's what happened to Gandhi, and that's what's happened in churches all across this great nation of ours, and really all across the entire planet. We set up rules, and people rebel against rules because we haven't established a relationship with them. Can you imagine walking up to somebody that you want to be your friend and telling what the conditions of your friendship are going to be? Instead of just loving them, and as you went along, you began to set the parameters of a relationship? But don't we do that as Christians? If you want to become a Christian, you have to do this, this, and this. And we don't let them love Jesus first. And because of rules, they rebel. Rules aren't enough. We need a relationship with Jesus Christ, because a relationship with Jesus Christ can give us a defined purpose. It can give us hope, and it can give us this incredible peace. The more you know Jesus, the more you can break down the wall between you and God. Now, there's a story in the Gospel of John. John was a man who walked with Jesus when he was here on earth, and he was a man who was very close to Jesus. In fact, he was what they call part of the inner three. He was one of the three men that were the very closest to Jesus. And he records this story, this account, in the Gospel of John, chapter 8, verses 8 through 11. It's the story of the adulterous woman. Now, maybe some of you know the story. Maybe some of you have heard this account before. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn there now. If not, we're going to have the words on the screen, but I'll be there in a few minutes. And I don't want you to get this wrong. I don't want you to think that I'm against rules, because rules are necessary. If we had no rules in this world, it would be chaos. But if you don't understand the reasons behind the rules, they're just seen as a bunch of things you can do and you can't do. For example, you know, I was a Gideon, a part of the Gideon's International for a lot of years. And once you become a pastor, you have to resign your membership from the Gideons. Now, when I first started looking at the Gideon's International, I thought it was the most legalistic organization I'd ever seen in my life. They only handed out two copies of the Bible at the time that I was going through versions of the Bible. One was the King James Version and one was the New King James Version, both of which I found very difficult to read and understand. When you spoke as a speaker and for the Gideon's International Church, your attire had to be a dark suit, a white shirt, and a dark tie. That's all they allowed. And I'm thinking, this is so legalistic. But when you find out the reasons behind rules, it changes everything. I found out the reason you only spoke from the New King James or the King James Version, because the King James Version is allowed in every church. You can go to the most conservative Southern Baptist church and speak out of the King James Bible, or you can go to the most liberal contemporary church and speak out of the King James Bible. But there are some versions of the Bible that if you speak out of in some churches, they'll close your ears and they'll never hear a word you said. They are offensive. And the Gideons never wanted to offend anybody. The other reason was copyright laws. King James Version, New King James Versions are not copyrighted, so they're much cheaper to print. When I understood the rules, I understand why they did. You know, we dress casually. But you go into some churches and you dress like we dress, you would be pushed out the door. They had you wear this dark suit with a white shirt and a dark tie because that's welcome in every church. The reason I had to resign my membership as a Gideon when I became a pastor is they're so concerned about God, they don't want their ministry to interfere with somebody else's ministry. And they feel if you have a calling to the pastoral ministry, that should come first. And nothing that you do should interfere with that. And if you were still a Gideon, it might interfere with it. So once I understood the rules, it was easy to understand why they had the rules in place. Now, rules are good. In fact, God gave us rules. But if you don't understand the reason behind the world, and we become so inflexible and legalistic that we can't even consider another way, then rules become this burden, this thing that we have to carry around, and it begins to lead to religion. And religion sometimes leads to people rebelling, or at the very least, walking away from the church. And sometimes, like Gandhi, they walk away forever. Because rules are burdensome. Rules can be a weight around your neck. And really, simply, there are some rules that are impossible to follow. And you don't know what they are because each church has its own set of rules. Now, whether they're written rules or they're just the way things have always been, that's what we do in this church. It doesn't matter. So you can't always follow rules because sometimes you don't even know what the rules are. And some rules are impossible to follow. And one of the things with rules is rules always follow rules. You have to make new rules up to interpret the old rules. You have to make up rule. I mean, just take a look at our country. We started with this very simple constitution. And then we added a couple amendments. And now we have libraries, volumes and volumes and volumes of books and laws to interpret the few laws that we initially had. And then we had to interpret and try to explain the simple constitution that we started with, and then explain all the rules that we put into the rules that made the rules that we have to interpret the new rules with. God gives us these Ten Commandments, and He laid out these things to show us how we're supposed to do things. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the religious people of the time, they come out and they start adding rule upon rule upon rule and tradition upon tradition to God's law. And they started being the enforcer. They started trying to make people follow God's rules. And they had these rules about God, but they didn't have a relationship with God. And sometimes we do that in our churches. And sometimes we do that as Christians. We trade rules for relationships. And really, you know, it's human nature. I think we do it for a couple of reasons. It's so that we can purposely be mean and cruel and enforce rules to people. But really, isn't it easier to follow a set of rules than it is to have a deeply committed relationship? I mean, that's why so many young people don't get married today, because they can't and they don't know how to get in a deeply committed relationship. So when someone comes along and they break the rules, they just walk away.
That's true.
It's easier to follow rules than it is to have a deeply committed relationship. Secondly, it's easier for me to see and for you to see if we're obeying the rules, because we can't see somebody's heart, but we can see their behavior.
That's
So I don't know what your relationship is with Jesus Christ. I don't know what your heartfelt feelings toward God are, but I can tell you whether you're following the rule book or not. So it just becomes easier. Now the Jewish leaders, the Pharisees and Sadducees, they're perfect examples of this. They were the ones that had the most rules and the most religions and the most traditions. And they tried to force others to live by their same policies, and they carried the heaviest burdens, and then they put those burdens on everybody else. And when Jesus, who was God himself, comes to earth, we find out those religious leaders, who were the very best at keeping the rules, and they were the very best at enforcing the rules by making everybody else try to follow the rules, were actually the ones that were the farthest away from God.
It is so true.
At the time, everybody thinks they're the closest to God. Jesus comes along and says, your rules have pushed you up. You have a wall between us and God. You're farther away than the sinners. You're farther away than that worst of the worst sinners. The prostitutes and the tax collectors will get into heaven before you.
Amen.
You know, I read this recently, and I thought it was such a great example. Abraham Lincoln one time, he's in a meeting with several of his leaders, and he says, how many legs does a dog have if we say his tail is a leg? Now that's simple math, right? 4 plus 1. You got 4 legs plus a tail that's a leg. We got 5 legs. What the leader said, we got 5 legs. Abraham Lincoln says, no. And he says, a dog still has 4 legs. You can call a tail a leg, but a tail is still a tail. And isn't what this whole series has been about? We got a lot of people who say they're following Jesus, but are they really following Jesus? Got a lot of people who say they're following Jesus, but are they just religious fans of Jesus? So if you have your Bibles, again, we'll go back to John chapter 8 after I got off that little thing there. And if you don't have a Bible, again, just follow along with me up here on the stage. And really, we're going to begin in chapter 7, verse 53, because it sort of goes along with this. So starting out with that, it says, then each went to his own home. He'd been teaching. They go back to their own home. And then Jesus goes to the Mount of Olives. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple court. So he gets up in the morning. He goes back. Now, he's in the most religious place in his city. He's in the temple court where all the people, and they gather around him. And at that time, the teachers sit down. So he goes to the temple courts where all the people gather around. He sits down and teaches. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees, the religious people, bring in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses, it commands us to stone such women. Now, what do you say? We've got these heavy rules. We've got these burdensome, cumbersome rules, and they're not inspiring any grace. The Pharisees had rules, but they weren't focused on a relationship with God. And because they weren't focused on God, they were focused on the rules and not on God, they wouldn't and they couldn't inspire any grace. So here's Jesus. He's in the courtyard, and he's sitting down, he's teaching. There's a big crowd around him, and all of a sudden, he is interrupted. And he's interrupted by this angry mob who just sort of burst onto the scene. And it's not an angry mob. A whole bunch of renegades, this mob that burst right into the temple grounds, sort of burst right into the church, is made up of the religious people. It's the pastors of the time. And they push and they shove this girl in front of the mob. And this woman, who maybe she's just dressed in a sheet, they caught her in the act of adultery. Maybe she's standing there naked. She's put in the middle of the crowd. She's put right in front of Jesus. And not only is she standing in the middle of this crowd, and in front of Jesus, I'm sure she's embarrassed. I mean, first of all, everybody knows what she's done. She's probably not dressed properly. She's been pulled out of bed. She's humiliated, and she's scared. She's on trial for her very life. One of the religious leaders gives the accusation to Jesus. Teacher, this woman is caught in the act of adultery. We found this woman, and she is in a bed with somebody who's not her husband. And the law of Moses, the rules of religious studies that we have here, the things that we have in front of us, the law, it says we have to stone it. What do you say, Jesus? Now, the problem isn't with the rules. The problem is with the hearts of the Pharisees. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 8 and 9, these people honor me with their lips. The Pharisees, they're honoring him with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, says Jesus. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules that are taught by men. See, Matthew 15 gives us a good description of the Pharisees and the Sadducees' hearts. But the unfortunate part is it also gives us a good description of a lot of Christians today, doesn't it? They worship in vain because their teachings aren't but rules of man. And when that happened, Jesus said, we're not honoring him. We may be honoring him with our lips, but our hearts are so far from him that everything we're saying and everything we're doing is just in vain. So they come to Jesus with this knowledge of the law. They knew all the rules, but they didn't come to enforce rules, really. They actually came to trap Jesus. Verse 6, John the disciple was probably a witness there that day, an eyewitness account. He records this. They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him meaning Jesus. The religious leaders, and this is so interesting. Now, see, they do it all the time. You'd think they would learn. The religious leaders used the rules to try and trap Jesus. The very law, the very rules that Jesus had wrote, that Jesus had given them. That's the second part of the triune God. They knew the law of God, but they didn't know God himself. God himself is standing right in front of them. And even though they knew the rules, they didn't know God. Rules will make you miss Jesus. Rules will make you miss Jesus even when he's standing right in front of you. Now please, please, please don't misinterpret what I'm saying. God's word provides both guidance and commandments, or laws or rules or whatever you decide to call them. And those laws are meant to protect us. They're given to us so that we can live the lives that we were created to have. They're given to us so we can live life and live it more abundantly. They're given to us so that we can see our need of a Savior, because we can't keep all the rules, so we need somebody to do it for us.
Amen. That's good.
Every single one of us has fallen short. Some of us in more public settings, some of us in more private settings, but we've all fallen short.
That's good.
We're all just simply a group of flawed people. We have our struggles. But here's the thing. When we overemphasize the rules, we get people to think that we got it all together. And deep down in our hearts, we all know we don't really have it all together. We just think we do at times. And sometimes we just pretend that we do. Sometimes as Christians, as religious people, we can be more like the Pharisees than we are the Messiah. We end up using these rules to rationalize how we treat people both inside and outside the church. Now, we especially like to go after the ones that are new to the church or new to Christianity, the ones who don't know the rules, the ones who have big sins who are hard to hide and difficult to hide. But that's not what Jesus calls us to do, and that's not the example that Jesus left us to do and set for us to do. And I know oftentimes Christians mean well, but in the process, we make it hard for people to see God, don't we? Mm-hmm. The message they hear is this. If you want to come to God, you have to follow all these rules that we have established. And they know they can't, and in some cases they know they won't follow the rules, so they just leave and never come back. Now, careful the next illustration, but I was a pastor of another church one time, and I've used this example here before, and I hate to repeat it, but it does point out the heart of many Christians. My wife Janet, there was a 16-year-old girl, and my wife Janet, living with her grandmother stepped up to the plate. Grandmother took the responsibility of being her guardian, because there's really no one left, and now her grandmother's raising her. But now her grandmother has just found out that she has cancer. And they don't know what the result's going to be. Her mom's just died of terminal cancer, so of course she's thinking the worst. But there's nobody for her to turn to, and there's nobody else for her to raise her. So this young 16-year-old girl, she's scared to death, and she's having a hard time trusting God at all. But Janet finally convinces her to come to our vacation Bible school, what we call the VBS, thinking maybe she would hear something or see something that would draw her closer to God. And she finally agreed to come. So on the first night, she comes to church. She's not dressed like most people there, and she's wearing this belt that's wide and has peace symbols all over it. And concrete steps walking up the door, and sitting on the step was a young Christian man who had great intentions. But when she comes up to the step, the first thing he told her well, you have to take that belt off because it's got peace symbols on it. And he began to condemn her and tell her how this belt was peace symbols on him. He began to tell her that peace symbols were demonic, and peace symbols had now symbolized the broken cross, and peace symbols were actually from Satan himself. None of that's true. But even if it was true, she just turned around and she walked away, and she never came back to that church. And the last time I saw her, she'd never been in any church ever again. The wall had been built up between her and God, and that wall was very difficult to get broke down. Because this young man, with all the right intentions, gave her a whole bunch of wolves that night, and the wolves were too heavy, they were too burdensome, they showed no grace at all, and she just walked away from the church, not feeling the love of Jesus, not wanting a relationship with him, but she left mad, she left angry, she left condemned, she left judged. See, when we have a bunch of rules, we frustrate and we wear out new believers. And sometimes we even wear out the old believers. Rules become heavy. Rules became a weight around our neck, because, and they never, ever, ever inspire grace. And in the process of keeping the rules, we make it hard for people to find and follow Jesus, and it makes it hard for us to lead them into a deeper relationship with God, which is the vision statement here at the Odyssey Church. This woman, this adulterous woman in John chapter 8, has been caught breaking the rules. And it's not a little rule. It is a big, big rule. It is one of the biggies. She broke the seventh commandment of God, thou shalt not commit adultery. And we know the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they don't really care that she's been caught in adultery. They're trying to trap Jesus because his word tells us so. Right. But more than likely, most commentators would tell you that most theologians believe this was actually a setup. Because in order to convict somebody, you had to have two witnesses. To even accuse them, you were supposed to have two witnesses according to the rules. So there had to be at least two guys standing out the window waiting for this girl to show up and commit adultery, right? And then he had to bring her to Jesus. And the second thing is, where's the guy? I mean, the law of Moses said in the Old Testament book of Leviticus, which is the book of the law, that's the book of the big rules, chapter 20, verse 10 says, if a man commits adultery with another man's wife and the wife of his neighbor, both the adulterer and the adulteress must be put to death. Where's the man? The rules, the law book says in Deuteronomy chapter 22, which is another Old Testament book, both of which all these religious leaders were required to memorize and quote from memory by the time they were 13 years old, says if a man is found sleeping with another man's wife, both the man and the woman he slept with must die. You must purge the evil from Israel.
Amen.
So where's the man in the story? The religious people. Now they set a trap for Jesus. And they think Jesus is about to get caught in a trap. The law of Moses, we must stone such women, Jesus. What do you say? Now, if Jesus says stone her, and he could have, that's what the law said. He could have said, my Father's law is very clear. You have to stone her, so stone her. And everyone could have sat around and picked up stones and pounded her body until it was just a bloody, broken corpse laying in the dirt. But if Jesus did that, people say, see, Jesus is teaching and preaching this love and this grace and this mercy, but he's practicing law. And the Pharisees would say, see, we told you Jesus isn't who he said he was. But if you let her go, they're going to say, see, this Jesus disobeys the law. See, we told you this Jesus wasn't who he said he was. Either way, they set the trap, and Jesus inside, and they think they got him. Here's the rules, Jesus. You say you're God, you're the one who even made these rules. Now, what are you going to do with them? But Jesus doesn't call us to follow rules, does he? He calls us to be in a relationship with him. Not to focus on the rules, which are necessary, but to focus on love, which is better. Instead of Jesus being trapped, he turns it, as he usually does, into a great teaching opportunity about his love and action. Luke 9:23 again, as I said earlier, the overarching verse of this story, Jesus doesn't say, if anybody comes after the law, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow all my rules. He doesn't say that. Jesus doesn't say, come after the rules. He says, come after me. If anybody would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Rules are heavy, they're a weight, they're cumbersome, they're burdens, and they don't inspire grace. So Jesus begins to tell them, last part of chapter 6, or verse 6 through verse 8, but Jesus bent down and started writing on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, if any of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw the stone at her. And again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And I think this is what Jesus is trying to teach us. And he's actually teaching us even about rule keeping, even though on the outside it doesn't appear that way. He says, when you have to make a decision between grace and law, when you have to make a decision between love and rules, choose loving grace. Rules are good, rules are necessary, but loving grace overrides the law most of the time. You know, we sort of wish we knew what Jesus was writing on the ground. We really wish it would say in the scriptures what Jesus was writing, but it doesn't. All we know is whatever he was writing on the ground was the very written word of God, because God was writing it on the ground. Some believe Jesus was writing the sins of the Pharisees. And they believe this because what was written in dirt, as he starts to write, they begin to leave. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time. The older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. See, the older ones left first because they had a longer list of sins. They were older, so they had more time to sin than the younger ones. Other people believe that Jesus was just simply ignoring them. He was acting like they weren't there. The King James actually interprets this verse like this. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. These Pharisees, these Sadducees, these religious leaders, the pastors of the time were looking to alienate. They were looking to destroy. They were looking to ruin. And Jesus was looking to restore and renew and redeem. So he just simply ignored them. But either way, their trap had failed. Because it's not about rules. It's about a relationship with Jesus. By saying the sinless person could throw the first stone, Jesus began to highlight the importance of compassion and forgiveness. He began to show them that rules were not enough. You know, when I got married to Janet, there were some rules that I would say that I would do. But I stood up with a pastor, and I said I'd be faithful to her as long as we both shall live. You know, I understood that I was going to be provided for her. I'm going to do my best to meet her needs, and I'm going to meet the needs of my family. I understood that I was committed to her for better or worse and to her alone. Now, I have to admit, there were some rules that weren't written. You know, there's been some rules that have since been established, like the kitchen counter in the kitchen. I am to keep that clean. I didn't say that publicly, but I found out the kitchen counter must remain clean. I found out that anything short of death is not a reason to bother her before noon on her day off. There's some things that I now know that I have learned, some rules that I've learned, that there's some things I just should never say out loud to her. I've learned this. But if I saw our relationship as just a bunch of rules that I had to keep and had to follow, I'm not going to be very happy in that marriage, am I? But because I love my wife, I try to find joy in being a good husband. And most of the time, I won't say all the time, I do some of these things because, not because of the rules that have been established and put in place and the things I promised, but because I love her and I want her to be happy. But I also overlook some of the things that bother me and her because I love her. I keep the rules, but I give her grace as well. Now, throughout this sermon series, we've had a short sermonette, and we're just going to wrap this up. I'm going to watch this sermonette, and then we'll close out, and we'll sing our theme song. And by closing out, I mean about 5 or 10 more minutes. Don't want to mislead you. Blue, turn up the blue one.
Because maybe a college-age child or an adult child is no longer following Jesus. And the parents usually want to know what happened. They want to know what went wrong. That's a hard question to answer. There's a lot of different possibilities, but I do my best just to listen to the story, to encourage them and to pray for their child. But not long ago, I was speaking in Houston, Texas, and after I was done speaking, this big man with this big belt buckle came up to me, but he had tears in his eyes. And he began to tell me the story of his prodigal daughter, who had left home and had walked away from her faith, was no longer following Jesus. But he didn't ask me what happened. He didn't seem to be looking for an explanation. In fact, with one sentence, he told me what he thought went wrong. He said, "We raised her in church, but we didn't raise her in Christ." If you ever go to the doctor and get an inoculation, they give you a little bit of a virus to try and make you immune to the real thing. I think that's what's happened to a lot of fans. They got a little bit of Jesus. Maybe at home, maybe at school, church, a little bit of Jesus and a whole lot of rules. Maybe a little bit of Jesus and a whole lot of tradition. But one of the most deadly things that can happen to your faith is to have just a little bit of Jesus. We raised her in church, but we didn't raise her in Christ.
You know, as I listen and hold that story, I sort of picture this man in Levi's, maybe a Western shirt, great big belt buckle, big man, rough man, coming up with tears in his eyes because his daughter, who he loves so much, has walked away from her faith, has walked away from Jesus. Something he never expected her to do. But he doesn't come looking for an explanation. He doesn't come to ask what's happened. In fact, he tells what happened. He said, we went wrong because we raised her in church, but we didn't raise her in Christ. You know, one of the most dangerous things to my faith growing up, and even as I've gotten older, is a whole lot of rules and just a little bit of Jesus. Not enough to have rules, we have to have this relationship with our risen Savior. We raised her in church, but we didn't raise her in Christ. And I know this from personal experience, and it sometimes breaks my heart. Because when our kids grow up and define Christianity as trying to keep some kind of moral code that we can't even keep ourselves, when our kids grow up and define Christianity as rules instead of defining Christianity as being a follower of Jesus, they will end up walking away from both. We think, well, they've got to understand these rules and they've got to understand these moral obligations of being a Christian. And while that's true, I'm just here to tell you, if you define Christianity this way, instead of defining Christianity as following Jesus, they're going to walk away from both the church and Jesus. They'll walk away from Jesus and the moral code. See, we have to define Christianity first and foremost as simply following Jesus. We can't expect to recruit a world to a set of standards that we can't even keep ourselves, to a set of rules we can't follow, if it wasn't for a relationship with Jesus Christ. We keep the rules not because we have to keep the rules. We keep the rules because we first had a relationship with Jesus. The world, the unsaved, aren't going to get on board with a bunch of rules unless they first know Jesus. So it must first and foremost be about following Jesus Christ. And sometimes the only Christ they're ever going to see is you. So we have to ask ourselves constantly, not one time, but constantly, this question. Am I being destructive or am I being constructive? Have I made it about religion? Have I made it about rules and laws instead of a relationship with Jesus Christ? Have I made it about following this legalistic steps? Or have I made it about being a disciple of Jesus Christ? Because rules are cumbersome and rules are burdensome and rules do not inspire grace. And rules will not keep us around. Verse 10 and 11 says, Jesus straightened up and asked the woman, "Where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir." "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus said. "Go now and leave your life of sin." See, first of all, I want you to look at this. Jesus does not condone. He does not overlook what she did.
Amen.
He tells her, go now and leave your life of sin. He's telling her to repent. He's telling her, go turn your life around and live a different life. Go and live a transformed life. Repentance is the key in his statement. Yes. But Jesus is gracious and he's merciful. Jesus never ceases to be holy. He always requires an action. He calls us to like the holiest. Be holy as I am holy. And be obedient. If you are my disciples, you will follow my rules. But he gives us the Holy Spirit and the resources we need to walk in this righteousness. And you can't have that unless you're first in a relationship with him.
Amen.
Because he doesn't say, go and follow the rules, young lady. Jesus begins by building a relationship with her. He doesn't say the rules say to stone you, so I'm going to stone you. I'm sorry, that's just the way it is. Jesus loves her. And I want you to know the same love that Jesus had for this young girl who broke one of the biggest rules that there were, is the same love he has for you when you break the rules.
Amen. Amen.
So when we mess up, he's there for us. If
we'll
just turn back to him for a relationship. He doesn't say, hey, well, you broke the rules. I'm done with you. He says, I want you to enter into a relationship. I want you to live differently. And then we end up following the rules because of a love relationship with him. When we're in a relationship with somebody, whether it's Christ or a friend across the street, we act and we do things differently if we truly love that person. The Apostle Paul, when he wrote his first epistle to the church, he said, we love because he first loved us. It's all about love. And in a relationship with Jesus, we're supposed to grow more and more like Jesus. But when we start adding rules and traditions and regulations, instead of us becoming like Jesus, we try to make Jesus become like us.
That's right.
And it's just about the rules. We actually start to move away from Jesus. We become like the Pharisees, and we move away from his love, and we move away from his grace, and we move away from his mercy. St. Augustine said, love God and do as you please. Now, how could he say that? Why would he say that? Love God, but do whatever you please. Now, here's the reason. If you know St. Augustine, you know his story. He was one of the most greatest disciples of Christ who ever lived. So how could he say these words? Because the restriction is in the first part. He says, love God. Because if you really have a love relationship with Jesus, I'm going to tell you, when you fall in love with Jesus, you're going to be surprised at the things you want to do for him. You'll be surprised at the things you want to do for Jesus. When you fall in love with Jesus and he begins to invade your life, you can do what you please because you'll want to please Jesus. Love God and do as you please because what you please to do is to please God. See, after Judas committed suicide for his guilt of betraying Jesus, 10 of the remaining 11 disciples were martyred, tortured, killed for their belief. Only John lived a ripe old age, and even John was exiled, persecuted, tortured at times. I'm going to tell you something. Rules don't motivate like that. You can't give me a set of rules to make me go through that kind of torture, pain, and be killed.
Right.
Rules won't get you to lay down your life for somebody else. Only a relationship of love can get you to lay your life down for somebody else. You have to love somebody in order for you to lay your life down. And when the church and when Christians focus on rules and not on the relationship, people get tired because they know they can't keep the rules. And they begin to struggle with the rules. And they end up leaving the church and they leave their faith. Or they just simply get worn out and you start going through the motions because they know, and we know, nobody can keep all the rules. The rules are heavy. They're burdensome. They don't inspire grace. And rules won't keep anybody around. So where do we put our focus? Do we put our focus on the rules, or do we put our focus on our relationship with Jesus Christ? Because if we put our focus on the rules, people might try and follow them for a while, but after a while they're just going to get tired and they're going to rebel. Because following rules never gives you any satisfaction. It doesn't fulfill you. It doesn't give you comfort. It doesn't give you peace. And Jesus wants us to be in a love relationship with him. And it's hard to recruit people into the kingdom of God by telling them, come and join our church and follow all these rules. But if you go out into the world and you tell people, God loves you. In fact, God loves you so much that he sent his son to die for you. He loves you so much he wants a relationship with you, and he wants to bring you comfort, and he wants to bring you joy, and he wants to bring you peace, and he wants to shape your life so that you're going to end up imitating him. If you tell them Jesus wants to transform you so that you can be more like Him, so that you can fill those empty places that are in your heart, He wants you to follow Him, not a bunch of rules, then we have a great chance of bringing people into the kingdom of God instead of running them away from the kingdom of God. That doesn't mean we don't warn people about sin. It doesn't mean we don't hold one another accountable. It just simply means that we can focus on the relationship. And if that relationship is strong, it will transform us. It will change the way we live. And it will possibly change the lives of those around us and how they live. See, because of my relationship with Janet, I can sit down and discuss about some things that maybe I don't like. And she can sit down and talk to me about things that I don't like. But there had to be a relationship. If we started our relationship that way, it would never work out. When you're given a choice between law and love, choose love. When you're given a choice between grace and rules, choose grace. But unfortunately, as a whole, church has been a toxic place for a lot of people. Instead of grace and loving people who are not like us and don't act like us and don't do the things we do, instead of lifting him up and restoring them, we sort of condemn him and beat him down. And it's not that, I mean, please don't misunderstand me. It's not that we condone their sins. It's not that we overlook their sin or even allow them to stay in their sin. But we have to lift them up. We have to restore them. We have to get into a relationship as Jesus does with this woman who's caught in this very sinful act of adultery. This is what I would like. Nothing would give me more satisfaction. Nothing would give me more joy than the Odyssey Church became known as a church that loved people no matter what they've done, no matter where they've been, and no matter what they're doing. The church and the people who attend here became known as a church that loved people no matter what. They could come here and they could feel the love of Jesus even if they were caught in terrible sin. What if we became known as a church who cared more about where people were going than what they were doing? Imagine what our church would look like if we all would do that. Imagine what our families would look like if we all do that. Imagine what our community would look like if we all had this love relationship with Jesus and not just a bunch of rules that everybody had to follow. Gandhi said, I love Christ. It's just that so many of you Christians are so unlike your Christ. Imagine what our world would look like if we all followed Gandhi's advice and Christians would really live according to the teachings of Christ as found in the Bible. Imagine what the world would look like if Christians gave each other grace and truly followed the teachings of Jesus. The church isn't supposed to be a place to beat people over the head with the Bible. It's not supposed to be a place where we make it a bunch of rules. It's supposed to be a place where we show the love of Jesus and we invite others into a love relationship with Jesus, and that is what is going to transform our life. See, rules are superficial. Relationships go deep. And that's why sometimes we just want to follow the rules because, first of all, it's just easier on us. And second, it's easier to see if somebody else is following the rules than it is to see if they're in a relationship. And a relationship with Jesus that's so deep, it can and will transform your life and their lives and all the lives of the people that we all come in contact. That's why fans go after rules and followers go after Jesus. Are you a fan or a follower? Are you living in a relationship with Jesus? Are you just following a bunch of religious rules? Are you pointing others to a bunch of rules? Or are you pointing them into a relationship with Jesus? Have you made it about the rules or have you made it about a relationship? See, I don't know what your story is. I don't know if there's been a Christian in your life who bullied you, who misrepresented Christ, who wasn't like Jesus at all. I don't know if it's a church that maybe taught you a lot of traditions and a lot of rules and a lot of regulations, but they never really got around to studying the gospel of Jesus and the scriptures. Maybe you grew up in a household or some kind of denomination or a religious group where nobody seemed to make a big deal out of grace, but they sure did make a big deal about your sin, and they make you feel guilty every week. But I want you to know, as a pastor of the church, as a follower of Christ, I'm speaking on behalf of this entire congregation when I say we want you to love Jesus. We'd love you to come here and experience the freedom that's found in knowing and following Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And maybe today that's you. I don't know. If that's you, these altars are always open. If you've experienced the Spirit of the living God this morning, if He's spoken to you, will you come? Now, you know, the interesting thing in this story is we don't know what happened to the woman, do we? We don't know this woman caught in adultery went back to her life of sin or she began to live her life for Jesus. But I bet you, when she experienced the love and the grace and the mercy that Jesus gave her that day, when she saw the fact that she was forgiven and she was set free and she was saved from certain doom, I bet she left her life of sin. I bet she followed Jesus, not because she had to, not because of some set of rules, but because He loved her first, because she loved Him and decided to follow Him. Why? Because she had experienced that radical love of Jesus Christ. She had an encounter with the Son of the living God. If you've had that encounter with Jesus, the Holy Spirit has spoken this morning, you're welcome to come as we sing our unofficial theme song, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Will you stand with me? Rules will encumber you. Rules won't show you the grace of Jesus. And rules won't keep you around. Are you a fan of Jesus or are you a follower of Jesus? Have you made it a matter of rules instead of a relationship with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior?
Piano.
While they're getting set up, let me pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank You for those that are here today. We thank You for this message on love and grace and mercy. Father, let us be more about the love of Jesus, the relation of Jesus, than we are about the rules and the regulations. Father, we know they're important, but until we see the love behind them, we can never follow. Open our eyes, open our hearts, open our minds to our living God. Amen.
All right.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
Thank you for coming today. God bless you.